lymphoid tissues. Lymphoid system. The different organs in the lymphoid system include tonsils, thymus, lymph nodes, lymphatic vessels, liver, spleen, Peyer's patch on small intestine, appendix, and bone marrow. Coming to the different type of cells in the lymphatic system. The chief cells are lymphocytes. It include B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. Also, there are natural killer cells and supporting cells. The chief cells of lymphatic system are B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. Additionally, there are natural killer cells and supporting cells. Other types of WBCs include, which are part of lymphatic system, monocytes, macrophages, neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils. Coming to the classification of lymphoid tissues, there are two classifications. First one is functional classification. So, lymphoid organs or lymphatic tissues are functionally classified into central and peripheral. Peripheral lymphoid organs or tissues include thymus and bone marrow. Central lymphoid organs include thymus and bone marrow. Peripheral organs are lymph node, spleen, malt, and galt. Malt is mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. And galt is gut-associated lymphoid tissues. Lymphoid organs are classified into two. First one is functional classification. It includes central and peripheral. The central lymphoid organs are thymus and bone marrow. Peripheral organs are lymph node, spleen, malt, and galt. The second classification is morphological classification. Morphologically, lymphoid organs are discrete and diffuse type. Discrete organs include lymph node, spleen, thymus, and tonsil. Diffuse organs are bone marrow and Peyer's patches of the small intestine. We will see in detail about the discrete lymphoid organs, which includes lymph node, spleen, thymus, and tonsils. Altogether, what are the functions of lymphoid tissue? They protect the body against foreign material. They assist in the circulation of body fluid between cells and bloodstream. Third, they transport dietary fat. So, protection against infection, assisting in the circulation of excess fluid, body fluid between cells and bloodstream, and a transportation of dietary fat. Let us see about the thymus gland. It is a bilobed organ. Bi means two. It has two lobes. This is the thymus gland, right lobe and the left lobe. Coming to the location of the gland, this is heart. It is situated above the heart or superior to the heart. These are great vessels on both sides. The thymus gland is situated anterior to the great vessels and superior to the heart. It is very large and most active during prenatal period and infancy. Prenatal period means pregnancy period. After puberty, it decreases in size. Then, it is composed of lymphatic tissues. The thymus is composed of lymphatic tissues. We have seen already that there are two lobes. Each lobe is subdivided into lobules. Immature T cells originating in the bone marrow migrate to the thymus via blood. In the thymus, these cells mature for release into circulation. Immature T cells are formed in bone marrow. They reach spleen via blood. Thymus via blood. In the thymus, they develop into mature T cells. Thymic hormone aid in the maturation of T cells. So, one of the functions of thymus gland is maturation of T cells. It is composed of lymphatic tissue. Each lobe is divided into lobules. the function of thymus gland is maturation of T cells. Coming to the structure of thymus gland. As we have seen already, this is the thymus gland, this is the right lobe and this is the left lobe. Then each lobe is subdivided into different lobules. This is one lobule, second, third and so on. Each lobe has a capsule. Then there is the capsule is extended into the parenchyma of thymus gland and that is called the interlobular septum. This is the capsule, this is the extension of the capsule and that is called the interlobular septum. In other words, the septum divides the thymus gland into different lobules. Then each lobule have a cortex and an inner medulla. In the medulla you can see thymic corpuscles. So the once again about the structure, each lobe has a capsule. The capsule extends into the parenchyma of thymus gland, dividing it into different lobules, and that is called, that extension is called the interlobular septum. Then it has an inner cortex and innermost medulla. Inside the medulla we can see thymic corpuscles. Then the changes of thymic structure with age. The thymus will undergo change in the structure according to the age. It is called involution. So as we have seen already, it is largest at birth. During the prenatal period or during pregnancy, at about 20 weeks it will become fully functional. Then after infancy, there is progressive involution of the adipose tissues of the thymus. This involution is accelerated by, or decrease in size is accelerated by, adrenal corticosteroids and sex hormones. Then in juveniles or during puberty or during adolescence, there is isolation of cortical compartment, reduction of cortical and medullary volume, appearance of more larger blood vessels. The cortex get isolated. Then there is cortical and medullary volume reduction and appearance of more larger blood vessels. So it will be large at birth, fully functional by 20 weeks during fetal life. Then after infancy, there is progressive involution or reduction in size of adipose tissue with the help of adrenal corticosteroids and sex hormone. In juveniles, there is gross change in the structure like isolation of cortical compartment, reduction of cortical and medullary volume and appearance of larger blood vessels. Coming to the applied anatomy of thymus gland. There is a condition called myasthenia gravis in which the thymus gland is involved. And there is one more condition called DiGeorge syndrome in which the thymus gland along with the other endocrine glands and cardiac outflow tract is defective. In DiGeorge syndrome, thymus will be absent. Myasthenia gravis is a disorder in which thymus gland is involved. That is in brief about the first lymphoid tissue, that is thymus. Let us see about lymph nodes, the second type of lymphoid tissues. The second lymphoid organ is lymph nodes. We have seen in the lymphatic system very briefly about lymph node, the structure of the lymph node. It has a capsule. The capsule has a submarginal, subscapular or marginal sinus. Then it has a cortex. Below the cortex there is paracortex. Then the innermost part is the medulla. It has a hilum or hilus through which the blood vessels enter and leave, and different lymphatic channels leave the lymph node. Then it has a afferent channel which brings lymph into the lymph node, and it has efferent channel which helps to drain the lymph, and also there is trabeculae which are extension of the capsule. In this slide we will see the flow of lymph. We have already seen in the lymphatic system how the lymph flows. This is the afferent lymphatic vessel which bring lymph into the lymph node. And in the lymph node, it passes through subscapular sinus, which is just below the capsule, then the cortical sinus, then the medullary sinus, and finally it is collected by efferent lymph vessel and it will drain in the corresponding lymphatic tract. About the location of lymph node. The lymph nodes are present around large arteries and veins. The lymph nodes are present around large arteries and veins. This is the presence of lymph nodes. So wherever there are large arteries and veins, we can see the presence of nodes here. This circle-like things are called nodes, lymph nodes. Then the major lymph nodes are cervical lymph node, axillary lymph node, celiac lymph node, mesenteric lymph node, and the inguinal lymph nodes. Coming to the applied anatomy, this also we have seen earlier in the lymphatic system. Some of the abnormal conditions of lymph node include lymphadenitis, which is the inflammation of the lymph node, lymphoma, which is the tumor of the lymph node, and we have seen that lymph nodes or lymphatic system have a significant role in the spread of cancerous cells, that is called the metastasis. Coming to the third lymphoid organ or lymphoid tissue, that is spleen. We have discussed about the thymus, lymph node, and thirdly we will discuss about spleen. It is the largest lymphatic organ. It is situated in the left upper quadrant of the abdominal cavity. This is the left upper quadrant of the abdominal cavity. That is the place where spleen is situated in close relationship with the stomach. It has the size of a cupped hand. When you make our hand in the shape of a cup, the spleen or the spleen of that person has the size of his or her cupped hand. What are the functions of spleen? The spleen serves five functions. First one, it filters blood. Second, it reacts immunologically to blood-borne antigens. Third, it removes defective blood cells. Four, it stores blood cells and platelets. And five, it is involved in hematopoiesis. Hematopoiesis is the production of blood cells. Filtering of blood, reaction to blood-borne antigen, removal of defective blood cells, storage of blood cells, and the hematopoiesis. This is the structure of a spleen. It's the largest lymphoid organ. Then, coming to the further details of spleen, it has a size of 1 × 3 × 5 inches. Has a size of 1 × 3 × 5 inches, weight 7 ounces, relation 9 to 11 ribs in the mid axillary line. If you count the number of ribs, the spleen is located between 9 to 11 ribs in the mid axillary line. That is the anatomical position of the spleen. Coming to the inner structure of the spleen, like any other lymphoid organ, has a fibrous capsule. This is the fibrous capsule. The capsule extends into the parenchyma of the spleen, that is called a trabeculae. Like in lymph node, extension of capsule into the parenchyma, that is called a trabeculae. In between the trabeculae, the splenic pulp lies. The substance of the spleen is called a splenic pulp. So in between the trabeculae, this is one trabeculae, this is another trabeculae. So this is the splenic pulp. You can see two types of splenic pulp here, the red pulp and the white pulp. The red pulp consists of the red color here, that consists of blood cells. In the red pulp, you can see spaces called sinuses, splenic sinuses. This is the red pulp, and this white colored thing in the red pulp is the sinuses. The red color is due to content of large amount of blood cells. White pulp, it is white in color due to the presence of lymphocytes. It is white in color due to the presence of WBCs, especially lymphocytes. They are arranged in the cylindrical fashion. This is the branch of an artery. This is an artery. So The white pulp is arranged around arteries in a cylindrical fashion. So about the structure, it has a capsule. The extension of the capsule into the splenic pulp, you can see trabeculae. In between trabeculae, you can see red pulp rich in RBC with the sinuses, and the white pulp rich in WBC, especially lymphocytes. The white pulp is arranged in a cylindrical fashion around an artery. Coming to the ligaments of spleen, the spleen has two important ligaments, the gastrosplenic ligament and the leno-renal ligament. Gastrosplenic ligament passes to greater curvature of the stomach, and the leno-renal ligament passes to posterior abdominal wall. About the relation of the spleen or the boundaries of the spleen. Posteriorly, the left dome or the left side of the diaphragm exists. It separates the spleen from the pleura, left lung, 9 to 11 rib. So posteriorly, in close relation with the spleen or behind the spleen, we can see the left dome of the diaphragm. Anteriorly, the stomach lies. Inferiorly, the transverse colon, the splenic flexure of transverse colon lies. Medially, left kidney. The tail of pancreas is related at the hilum of the spleen. So posteriorly, left part of the diaphragm, anteriorly stomach, inferiorly splenic flexure of transverse colon, medially kidney, and to the hilum, the tail of the pancreas. So this is the picture of the relation. Here you can see the spleen. This is the left diaphragm. This is the stomach. This is the pancreas. And this is the transverse colon, which is missing here. And this is the left kidney. Then coming to the blood supply. The arterial supply comes from splenic artery, and the venous drainage is from or is through splenic vein. Coming to the clinical anatomy, splenectomy is the removal of spleen. Then if there is any wound to the left chest, the spleen gets easily damaged, or if there is any blunt trauma to the abdomen, spleen also easily damaged because it is rich in blood vessels, RBC. Then there is something called the accessory spleen. Accessory spleens. These are additional spleen which may occur near the hilum or in the tail of pancreas, omentum, mesentery, ovary, and even in testis. These are some of the places where additional spleens can be seen. It is very rarely seen. Coming to the next lymphoid organ or tissue, that is tonsils. We have covered thymus, spleen, and lymph node. Now we will see about the tonsils. The tonsils are collections of lymphatic tissue located in the pharynx. Tonsils are located in the pharynx and they are collection of lymphatic tissue. They are classified as mucosa-associated lymphatic tissue, MALT. They are classified as MALT, that is mucosa-associated lymphatic tissue. It contains T cells, B cells, and macrophages. Like other lymphoid organ, they have an important role in fighting infection. So they are located in pharynx. They contain T, B, and macrophages. It fight against infection. They collectively form a ringed arrangement in the pharynx. In the pharynx, these tonsils form a ringed arrangement, that is called the Waldeyer's ring. This is the Waldeyer's ring. The Waldeyer's ring are formed by four tonsils. The pharyngeal tonsil, tubal tonsil, palatine tonsil, and a lingual tonsil. This is the pharyngeal tonsil, which is nothing but adenoid. Then on both sides we can see tubal tonsils. Again, bilateral palatine tonsil and lingual tonsil. Palatine tonsils are bilateral, tubal tonsils are bilateral,
the pharyngeal tonsil 1 and the lingual tonsil form a ring shaped structure or ring shaped lymphoid tissue that is called the Waldeyer's ring. Then this picture further explains the presence of different tonsil. This is pharyngeal tonsil. This is palatine tonsil. Here you can see tubal tonsil. In this picture we cannot see here. Then this is the lingual tonsil. Lingual tonsil as at the base of the tongue. Pharyngeal tonsil in the roof of the mouth near to the ula. Palatine tonsil at the side of the pharynx. Pharyngeal tonsil the roof of the pharynx. Palatine tonsil the side of the pharynx and lingual tonsils at the floor of the pharynx near to the base of tongue. Let us see in brief about different types of tonsils. First about pharyngeal tonsils. They are in the roof of nasopharynx. When they are enlarged, it is called adenoids. So enlarged pharyngeal tonsils are called adenoids. It forms the superior aspect of Waldeyer's ring. The upper part of Waldeyer's ring is formed by pharyngeal tonsil. It has an epithelial covering which is made of ciliated pseudo-stratified epithelium. Its blood supply comes from 6 arteries: ascending palatine artery, ascending pharyngeal artery, pharyngeal branch of maxillary artery, arteries of pterygoid canal, basophenoid artery, tonsillar branch of facial artery. So pharyngeal tonsils have rich blood supply, which is very important or which has to be remembered while tonsillectomy, that is removal of the tonsil. And its venous drainage is via numerous small veins and empty into pharyngeal plexus. Venous drainage by numerous veins getting emptied into pharyngeal plexus. The nerve fibers comes from vagus and the glossopharyngeal nerves. The lymphatic drainage is into the retropharyngeal nerves and deep cervical nerves. So remember, the pharyngeal tonsil situated in the roof of nasopharynx, when it is enlarged, it is called adenoids. It forms the superior aspect of Waldeyer's ring. It has rich blood supply from 6 important arteries. The venous drainage into pharyngeal plexus, nerve fibers from vagus and glossopharyngeal nerve, lymphatic drainage into retropharyngeal and deep cervical nerves. Coming to the tubal tonsils, they are seen around the opening of Eustachian tube in the lateral wall of nasopharynx. It forms the lateral aspect of Waldeyer's ring. It has an epithelial covering by ciliated pseudo-stratified epithelium. The blood supply is from ascending pharyngeal artery. Venous drainage into the pharyngeal plexus. The nerve supply is from maxillary and glossopharyngeal nerves. Lymphatic drainage into retropharyngeal and deep cervical nerves. Same like tubal pharyngeal tonsils. It is situated in the lateral wall of nasopharynx around the Eustachian tube, lateral aspect of Waldeyer's ring. Epithelial covering same as that of pharyngeal tonsil. Blood supply mainly from ascending pharyngeal artery. Venous drainage, innervation and lymphatic drainage is same as that of pharyngeal tonsils. Coming to the third type of tonsil, that is palatine tonsils. Palatine tonsils are commonly referred to as tonsils. So tonsils simply means palatine tonsil. They are located in the lateral wall of oropharynx. They form the lateral part of Waldeyer's ring. It has a free medial surface which projects into the pharynx, and the lateral surface has a fibrous capsule. It is covered by stratified non-keratinized squamous epithelium. It is different from the epithelium of other two types of tonsils. Stratified non-keratinized squamous epithelium is seen in the palatine tonsils. Coming to the blood supply, it is mainly from tonsillar branch of facial artery. Venous drainage is via external palatine vein. Nerve supply is from maxillary and glossopharyngeal nerve. Lymphatic drainage is into jugulodigastric and upper deep cervical lymph nodes. Then, about the clinical condition of tonsil, it is called tonsillitis. It refers to the inflammation of palatine tonsils. So, tonsillitis refers to the inflammation of palatine tonsils. It can be caused by viral infections most commonly and also bacterial causes. So, that is about different types of lymphatic tissue. Thank you so much for patient listening.